is my song, O God of all the nations, a song of peace for lands afar and mine. This is my home, the country where my heart is. My holy shrine, but all the heart in all the lands are beating with hopes and dreams as true and high as mine. My country's skies are bluer than the ocean, and sunlight beams on clover leaf and pine. But all the land have sunlight too and clover, and skies are as blue as mine. Oh, hear my song, thou God of all the nations, a song of peace for their land and for mine.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Today we celebrate the birthday of our nation. We celebrate, and especially on a Sunday, we recall the many gifts that our God has given our country. And yet we also acknowledge that the fullness of human freedom and liberty comes from God alone. Freedom from sin, freedom from fear, the freedom to enter into the gates of heaven and be in the eternal presence of God for all of eternity. Mindful of this great calling of ours through baptism and in the life of Christ, we begin our celebration of the Eucharist this morning, asking the Lord for forgiveness for our sins.
I confess
to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault, therefore I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, Heavenly King, O God of
Let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. As the Lord spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard the one who was speaking say to me, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have revolted against me to this very day. Hard of face and obstinate of heart are they to whom I am sending you. But you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God, and whether they heed or resist, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that a prophet has been among them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to to the Corinthians, brothers and sisters, that I, Paul, might not become too elated because of the abundance of revelations. A thorn in the flesh was given to me, an angel of Satan, to beat me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. I will rather boast most gladly of my weaknesses, in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and constraints, for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus departed from there and came to his native place, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What kind of wisdom has been given him? What mighty deeds are wrought by his hands? Is he not the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his native place, and among his own kin, and in his own house." So he was not able to perform any mighty deeds there, apart from curing a few sick people by laying his hands on them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Ezekiel had a tough job sharing an unpopular message of repentance to people who really didn't want to hear it. They didn't want to be reminded that there is an objective truth. After all, that objective truth might hamper their lifestyle, challenge them to change their ways, and bottom line, just prove to be inconvenient. Instead, it might be easier just to ignore old Ezekiel. The scripture tells us that they are hard of face and obstinate of heart, and that they were a rebellious house. Does that sound maybe vaguely familiar as our nation celebrates 245 years of independence? Just what was Ezekiel's job as a prophet? to convince everyone with his brilliance, to nuance the message so that it could be delivered without being offensive to his hearers? No, neither of these. Thank goodness Ezekiel wasn't distracted by tracking the number of his Facebook followers or how many likes he attracted. No, Ezekiel had the job of a prophet, which isn't to tell the future, and it certainly isn't to be liked or to be popular. It's simply, or very often not so simply, to tell the truth to unwilling ears. Thus says the Lord God. You know, sometimes we all need to be reminded of the truth and just what it is that God is saying to us. Jesus gives us a glimpse as to just what kind of reception might await a prophet. As he shared the truth in the synagogue, people who thought they knew him were astounded. Where did he get all this? Who does he think he is? And they took offense at him. Not that Jesus offended them, but they chose to be offended by Jesus. I wish it was always going to be easy, but if we speak the truth in love, our friends may well take offense at us too. Some 60 years ago, a saint was in the midst of the Catholic Church, but many people didn't know it. Far from it. When he did what he did, they didn't want to canonize him. They wanted to ridicule him, to marginalize him, to prove him wrong, just get rid of him. But in the end, the truth won out. In July of 1968, we had this saint warning the church that widespread use of artificial contraception would lead to five things, and I quote, increased marital infidelity, general lowering of moral standards, that man may forget the reverence due to a woman, that governments may even impose contraceptive use on everyone, and people may give into the hands of public authorities the power to intervene in the most personal and intimate responsibility of husband and wife, unquote. As fate would have it, since 1968, the world has indeed experienced widespread use of artificial contraceptives. And I also think this saint's prediction were sadly spot on these 53 years later. Marital infidelity has increased, and our moral standards have plummeted. More than ever before, man objectifies women rather than reverencing women. We've seen government intervention in mandating the distribution of contraceptives, even with the Little Sisters of the Poor, and even to the point of government-imposed sterilization and limits on childbirth. Challenging our culture of death requires courage. And Saint Pope Paul VI had courage in writing his 1968 papal encyclical, Humanae Vitae. Even when his advisors told him that, you know, a more socially acceptable message, a more popular message might be used, he instead trusted God. He wasn't interested in what people thought. He was interested in what God thought. He served his role as a modern prophet. And he was correct. He spoke the truth that the world needed to hear, but didn't want to believe. What truths do does our world need to hear today? Not what the world wants to hear, but what the world needs to hear. The truth that artificial contraception continues to be an inherent evil, and we continue to suffer the consequences that Saint Pope Paul VI outlined. The truth that marriage has been ordained by God to be between one man and one woman for life. The truth that abortion is the intentional killing of an innocent human being, and it should be illegal. In speaking against abortion, we also need to be mindful of the women and the men who have suffered through an abortion. They deserve our prayers and our support, and they need to know that there is help for them to heal. Help through programs like Project Rachel, which has helped thousands to heal from the tragedy of an abortion. Speaking truths like these in this building is a relatively safe space. What about sharing these truths with our friends and our neighbors, or with our coworkers, or even our own family members? Not always so easy. If we do, we risk alienating them. They might take offense at us. Well, as we hear in today's gospel, we wouldn't be the first. St. Paul shares a key insight that makes this difficult task of sharing the truth with an audience that might not want to hear it, that is the role of being a prophet, doable. In his vision, our Lord told Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness." So Paul learned not to lament his own weakness, but to depend on God's strength dwelling in him. "For when I am weak, then I am strong." In just a few minutes, we'll be invited to come forward to receive Jesus in the Eucharist. And when we do, let us be mindful that we are receiving all of him, all of his truth, even those things that challenge our faith and might seem difficult or inconvenient. We might pray with St. Paul that our Lord might give us his grace to make up for our weakness. Today, we celebrate our birth as a nation, our independence. As we celebrate our national independence, let's also take a moment to renew our total dependence on God. Let's renew our commitment to remain one nation under God. And let us also pray that once again, even today, God raises up new prophets like Ezekiel to share the truth to a world that doesn't know the truth or knows it, but would rather deny it. And be aware that the prophet to be raised up might just be that tentative-looking one staring back at you in the mirror.
I believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father,
Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Gathered together as brothers and sisters in Christ, we offer our prayers to the Lord.
For Pope Francis and all the bishops, that they may lead the Church to ever more perfectly be a prophetic witness to the truth of God's love and the gospel of Jesus Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For God's blessing on our nation as we celebrate Independence Day, that we will remain always grateful for the freedom that comes from following Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the men and women in our military, at home and abroad, and for all the public safety personnel who serve our nation, that they be kept safe and rewarded for their generosity and sacrifice, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an increase in vocations to the priesthood, the diaconate, and to consecrated life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace this week to love and honor Christ in our homes and in every aspect of our lives, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and suffering of our parish, especially Cody and family, Ralph, Jose Luis Olivo, Rose Caducanel, all COVID-19 victims and those that care for them, those who have asked for our prayers, and those for whom we have promised to pray, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Al Beck, Father John Nwanza, and Mark Friday, that they be raised up to the fullness of heavenly life in Christ Jesus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of Kristen Billington and Yvonne Rice, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are on the Holy Family prayer list and all those intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary, we ask that you hear the prayers we offer today and that you grant them through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our offertory hymn is number 572, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say, number 572.
Jesus say, behold, I
stoop down and drink and live. I came to Jesus and I drank of that life-giving stream. My thirst was quenched, my soul revived, and now I live in Him.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of His name, for our good and the good of all His church. May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through his paschal mystery, he accomplished the marvelous deed by which he has freed us from the yoke of sin and death, summoning us to the glory of now being called a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for your own possession, to proclaim everywhere your mighty works, for you have called us out of darkness into your own wonderful light. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become for us the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for your unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Andrew our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God,
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. For those who'd like to receive the Eucharist on the hand only, please come up to the catheter side of the church. For those who'd like to receive the Eucharist on the tongue or on the hand, please come to the ambo side of the church.
First Communion hymn is number 746, Shepherd of Souls, Refresh and Bless, number 746. Our second communion hymn is O Lord, I Am Not Worthy, number 672, number 672. Speak the words of comfort.
prayer for spiritual communion for those at home. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for our announcements. In honor of our observance of the 4th of July, on the 5th of July, tomorrow, Monday, we will have one Mass at 9 o'clock in the morning. The regular daily schedule of confessions and Mass will resume on Tuesday. Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock in the Ministry Center continues our summer catechism series. The topic for this week is part two of the Catholicism and Protestantism presentation by Deacon Dave. A reminder that Archbishop Belisario has ended the dispensation from the obligation to attend Sunday Mass. So he's ending that dispensation from the obligation, meaning all Catholics are now obliged to attend Sunday Mass starting today. All Catholics are obliged once again to attend Sunday Mass. Copies of the Archbishop's letter to the faithful regarding this dispensation are in the back of the church. There are some exceptions to the Sunday obligation that are outlined in his letter. We will continue to live stream our Sunday Masses. Finally, we welcome all those who are visiting us today, hoping that your time and travel here in Alaska is truly a blessed one, with good weather, wonderful sights and views of the many, many wonderful glorifications of God in this wonderful land. And on behalf of all the Dominican friars and the staff of Holy Family Old Cathedral, we wish you all a happy 4th of July. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Our recessional hymn is America the Beautiful, number 432, number 432. Beautiful for spacious skies, for and the waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties, above the fruited plain, America, America, God shed His grace on. Shining sea, O beautiful for pilgrim feet, whose stern impassioned stretch.